why do atoms exist? Why is radioactivity such a weak force? If it wasn't weak, then life would be impossible. So we know that atoms are made up out of electrons, which are in a cloud around a central nucleus. But why do they stick around and form a cloud? Why don't they just fly away? If they didn't have any mass, they would always travel at the speed of light, and there would be no way to glue them together with the nuclei to make atoms. So we need to understand where the electron gets its mass. Why are the weak forces responsible for radioactivity so weak? They're weak because the particle that generates those forces is very heavy. Why is it heavy? Where does its mass come from? So that is the big puzzle that faced physicists in the 1960s. Where do particle masses come from? And there was a theory proposed by Peter Higgs and colleagues in 1964, which predicted that there would be a universal field throughout all of space, and that there would be a quantum of that field that came to be called the Higgs boson. And that Higgs boson was indeed discovered at CERN, at the Large Hadron Collider, in 2012. So let's go back to 1964. So at that time, people were just beginning to understand what we call the standard model of particle physics that's written on the pullover. So we knew about the electron. We were just beginning to understand that inside nuclei there were things called quarks. And people were just beginning to write down theories of the fundamental interactions, if you like, the top line of the pullover. But there was a puzzle. Where did those particles' masses come from? Now, several groups of theoretical physicists were working on this problem, and they were borrowing ideas which came from other areas of physics, in particular the theory of superconductivity, and they took over those ideas and brought them into the area of particle physics. So the most famous of those is Peter Higgs, but actually he wasn't the first. Shortly before him, two Belgian theorists, François Englert and Robert Brout, proposed a very similar idea, and then many other people came along afterwards. So what's the idea? So we're familiar with the idea of a field. So we talk about a gravitational field. The gravitation of the field of the Sun keeps the Earth in its orbit. We're familiar with electromagnetic fields. We know about electric charges, they generate fields. Electric charges attract if they're opposite, repel if they're different, and so on. So we used to have this idea that there's this thing that we call a field that extends through space. So what Englert, Brout, and Higgs proposed was a new type of field, represented by phi on my t-shirt, which was different from the gravitation and electromagnetic fields. It's constant throughout all of space. It's the same in all directions. It's completely homogeneous, isotropic, and universal. And according to this theory, particles get their masses from interacting with this universal field. So I'm not going to go into the mathematics of it. but I will give you an analogy for thinking about it. So imagine that you are in Siberia in the middle of winter. So you've got this universal layer of snow absolutely everywhere. And imagine that you're trying to cross Siberia. So if you're lucky, you're going to have skis and you go skimming very fast across the top. And that's like a particle. Think, for example, the photon, the particle of light, that does not interact with the Higgs field. And it always travels at the same very high speed, the same way that the skier travels very fast because the skier does not sink into the snow. The analogy is that it doesn't interact with that Higgs snow field. But maybe you don't have skis. Maybe you have snowshoes. So then you're going to go more slowly. You're going to sink into the snow. That's like a particle that interacts with the Higgs field. And because it interacts with the Higgs field, it goes more slowly. It has a mass, travels less than the speed of light. And of course, it's possible that maybe you're trying to walk across Siberia in your boots. If you do that, you're going to go very, very slowly because you interact very strongly with the snow field. And the analogy would be with a particle that interacts very strongly with this universal Higgs field and always travels much slower than the speed of light. So that's the theory. Your mass depends on how strongly you interact with this universal Higgs field. And mathematically, it's represented by the third line on the pullover. Now, how do you test this idea? Well, what is snow made of? What's the quantum of snow? Snowflake. So, analogously, there is a quantum, a smallest unit of this Higgs field, and that's what we call the Higgs boson, because amongst all the people who proposed the idea back in 1964, he was the only one who specifically pointed out the necessary existence of this particle. Now, of course, there's many different shapes of snowflakes, and that's because snowflakes are made up out of water molecules that you can arrange in different ways. So in the same way, we're still arguing about whether there is just one Higgs boson or whether there's many, many different types of Higgs boson or related particles which are made up by rearranging some sort of more elementary constituent in different ways. But for the moment, we've only seen one Higgs boson and it looks as if it's an elementary particle. Okay, so this idea was proposed in 1964, and people didn't pay a lot of attention. I think that together with two colleagues, Mary Gaillard and Dimitri Nonopoulos in 1975, we were perhaps the first to look at the Higgs boson systematically to try to figure out what it would look like in an experiment. Although at that time, in the 1970s, these ideas were still regarded as being quite speculative. And so we actually wrote in our paper that we didn't want to encourage big experimental searches for this particle. Fortunately, our advice was not taken. And in the 1990s and the 2000s, people built the Large Hadron Collider at CERN. So it collides protons at very high energies, it can make all sorts of new particles, and it had many different scientific objectives. But one of the principal objectives of the Large Hadron Collider was to look for the Higgs boson and try to establish, for once and for all, does this mythical particle exist or not? So the Large Hadron Collider started making high energy collisions in 2010, and gradually 2011, beginning of 2012, rumors started going around that maybe two of the experiments called ATLAS and CMS were perhaps seeing evidence for something that might be the Higgs boson. Finally, on July the 4th, 2012, there was a big seminar at CERN when the ATLAS and CMS experiments both announced that they had discovered a new particle which looked like it had the right properties to be the Higgs boson. So as you can imagine, this was a really big event in the world of particle physics. And so Peter Higgs actually came to this presentation of these results, and he had a little bit of tears in his eyes. And he said afterwards that he'd never expected to see this particle discovered in his lifetime. Well, actually, on July the 4th, 2012, we knew we discovered a new particle, but we could not be sure that it was the Higgs boson. We had to check that it had the right properties. For example, it should couple to other particles proportional to their mass. So we had to check that, and together with my student, Devong Yu, we analyzed the data, and everything looked good. And there were other properties of the Higgs boson that needed to be checked. And finally, in 2013, everybody was convinced, and Peter Higgs and François Englert got the Nobel Prize in 2013. So now we have in our hands this particle called the Higgs boson. We're checking its properties to see maybe there's some sort of deviation from the predictions of the standard model. We're looking to see whether there's maybe other Higgs bosons. We want to understand why the Higgs boson has the mass that it does. All these are open questions that we remain to study.